software doesn't seem to be working right now. Okay, it's starting. As we always do, we just jump right into it. Start the engine, right? 1,000 horsepower. Boom. Okay. So, when you're in a 1,000 horsepower car, you start the engine. You better feel committed, right? You're committed. So we just start the engine like this. So welcome, welcome, welcome here to a most auspicious day. Now, ask yourself, why are you here in this world? I can answer this question. People will ask, why am I here? Because previously you have not had one habit, the one essential habit that you must have. You neglected it. That's why you're here. Okay? So this is the sovereign answer for why is everyone here? And 100 years from now, 1,000 years from now, if you're watching this video, you will say, why am I here? Because you neglected in the past, you have neglected this one essential habit, more essential than breathing, more essential than eating, more essential than anything. You neglected it. You allowed yourself to be distracted from it. You didn't use your will to insist upon it. That's why you're watching this. That's why you're here in this world. That's the only reason. And if you neglect it again, then maybe 100 years, 200 years, you'll be watching this again and you say, why am I here again? What happened? Why am I here? I'm confused. So as long as you neglect this one habit, you will continue to show up again and again and again and again and again and again. Coming and going, coming and going, coming and going. So there's one habit that you must do. Now you eat every day, right? That's a habit. You eat every day. You sleep, you eat. Okay, so there's one habit that's more important than those. So you're going to neglect that habit? Because neglecting that habit gets you a return ticket here every time. Every time. You stay within the realm, within the dream of coming and going, coming and going, coming and going. Whatever arrives will leave. Arriving and leaving, arriving and leaving, coming and going. You'll stay with that. And you'll always wonder, why am I here? You know, what am I doing? What's going on? I'm confused. Well, you're neglecting this one habit. It's the reason why you're here. So, this one habit is all essential, all essential. So this is the one thing I have done is this one habit for about 40 years. So it's the one habit that's so important, you cannot neglect it. And you say, you don't ask yourself, well, am I going to be eating my whole life? You know, can I eat like a couple years and then stop eating? Or can I breathe for a couple years and stop breathing? No, you say, my whole life I'll be breathing, my whole life I'll be walking, I'll be eating, I'll be talking, I'll be sleeping, you know, I'll have these habits for my entire life, right? So you know that. But this one all-important habit, you have to say also, I'll have this habit for my whole life. It is an essential part of my life, the most essential part. And we live in a ship of fools here in this world because everybody neglects this one habit. That's why they're here. This is the world of negligence. When you're negligent, you find yourself here. And you have this habit of negligence. So it keeps going on and on, this habit of negligence. This is the trouble. This is the trouble. Now, you might have a lot of other habits to kind of compensate, but most refuse to do this one habit. What is this one habit? This one habit is to practice super intensity every day. Super intensity. And there's only one way to experience the super intensity is this commitment to doing nothing. Commitment to no reaction, to doing nothing. And just full stop in the wow of the shock of that, is practicing this every day. So I've been able to do this, and the fruits are arriving of this practice. The fruits are ripening for me. So this is why I'm speaking in this way. I'm still practicing it, of course, yes. Very much so. In fact, the last several days, especially yesterday, was the most super intense of all. And you must develop the skill, as the super intensity arises, to handle it without going back into intensity. Because when you try to put super intensity into intensity, then the mind is going in all different directions and you feel pulled this way and that way. So the super intensity, when you come out of it to back into regular intensity, this is the key to succeeding with this. How do you re-enter intensity, the world of intensity, the realm of intensity of coming and going, when you have been bathing in the realm of no coming and going, super intensity? Committed, absolutely committed to no reaction, taking no action, making no reaction, and allowing the super intensity to arise within you. And it will. As long as you're able to then get back to regular intensity, the super intensity will arise within you in some way. You'll experience it. But you must be dedicated to giving yourself the time to then re-enter into regular intensity without trying to integrate anything, without trying to make any sort of integration. Don't integrate the two. This full stop in the wow enables us to do that. As I often said, super intensity is like this huge, massive bell just being rung, just hammered, and it just... And you're just sitting there, just wow. And then you realize that this is a totally different, this is intensity than what I'm used to. And then you at some point you might start panicking and say, well, how do I get back to my normal intensity? Right? So this is the problem. You don't try to get back to your normal intensity. You just refuse to take any action at all except just patiently sit here. And gradually, the vibration of that super intensity, it settles down, settles down, settles down, settles down. And you just let it settle down. Without doing anything about it, not trying to stop it, not trying to do anything. Because as soon as you start trying to do something with intensity, you'll end up being caught up in intensity in all different directions. Should I do this? Should I do that? Should I do that? Let me try this. Oh, wait, that's not working. Let me try that. And the confusion will arise and nervousness will arise in you. Just let it settle down naturally. So just trust it will. And at some point, then you're just able to just easily go back into your life smoothly. It's like you've forgotten the super intensity. You're not trying to focus on it. You're not trying to remember it, not to do anything about it. So what this does is enables us to get familiar with super intensity at the same time function in the world. But you must practice this every day. And in this way, super intensity can dawn upon us more and more, and yet we're able to smoothly function in the world at the same time. But it takes this commitment of every day, set aside some practice every day. Now, how do you do that? How have I been able to do this? Well, just absolutely essential. And so I just insist upon it. I just do it. I don't tell anybody I'm doing it necessarily. If I have to, I'll just say, well, I'm taping, that's it. This is my habit. This is what I do. And so you just decide you're going to do this. It does, you know, it can it be the same time every day? Some people like that. For me, I'm more abstract in terms of when I do. So it's just, I make sure to seize the moment when it's right. I say, sometime today I have to do it. If it's late at night, then I'll have to do it then. If it's a weekend, I do it like in the morning. First thing, I get up, boom, right away. Let me do this. Let me get on it right away before I'm distracted by anything else. Now, it greatly helps. There are things that are greatly help to do this is your lifestyle and the people you're around. Now, it's certainly not good to be around those who don't have this habit, because they're very negligent people. Very negligent, and their negligence will get them a return ticket here. And you don't want a return ticket here. Nobody really does. So if you hang out with negligent people, you yourself will become negligent. So for me, this is meant for me not having any friends. I don't know anybody who practices like this. I don't know anyone who isn't negligent, actually. So I just don't hang. I keep my own company. I don't hang out with other people because they're negligent. They neglect this. They neglect this one essential habit. And so that will get into me for sure. I'll start, because they'll say, oh, let's do this. Hey, call you on the phone. Let's go do this. I don't get any phone calls. I don't have any friends, so I don't get any phone calls. I don't get any mail either. I don't get any mail. I don't get any phone calls. I don't have people inviting me anywhere. I get zero invitations to anything, basically. Okay. Now, family is, they just get used to it. You just insist, you know, no, I don't care what you say, you know, I have the tape, that's it. And they get used to it, and you know, sometimes they get cranky, but then you know, you still function normally in your life. I still work full time, you know, and do everything you gotta do, shop, do everything. Okay? Right in the midst of the turmoil of life. But, you know, when I come home from work, you know, get quick dinner. Everything's simple, quick. Okay, save time. So I save time to make time to practice. So your habits become simple, your lifestyle becomes simple. So you have the time, and you have to cut out stuff like a cut out television, cut out sports, cut out you, the stuff that absorbs your time. Sometimes you have to cut out Facebook, right? Yeah, take a break from Facebook. That can really absorb your time. I don't have a smartphone, so I'm not constantly, right? You can't afford these distractions. So I have just a laptop. If I go to Facebook, I'm often editing video, so I go to Facebook when I'm uploading and editing video. So I'm multitasking. So that's fine. But no distractions. Now, you might think, well, how do I get such a lifestyle? Well, you will naturally be led into such a lifestyle as you continuously insist upon this one habit is the most important. So everything else has to take its place in relation to that. This is the center of my life, actually. This one practice is the center of my life. So every day we practice this making super intensity of no judgment. It will arise for you in all sorts of different ways, but you will feel that you've gone into this super intense zone, mental zone of this is different. I have a different perspective fundamentally. This is very intense. I can feel my whole psyche is like an earthquake. It's just wow. And then you practice, of course, staying with that as long as you can, and then the transition back into normal intensity has to be managed properly. Full stop in the wow has to be part of it. Otherwise, you'll quit the practice because it's too ragged for you. It's too ragged. So you have to smooth out this practice so your life is smooth. My life is smooth. It's not all ragged. People can count on me. You know, it's I'm calm, I'm humorous, I'm smooth, everything is fine. Because I know how to full stop in the wow and settle back down into normal intensity. And trust it is the most important advice. Trust it. Trust this way. So you know you can get back tomorrow, because tomorrow you'll be practicing again. So you don't worry, oh, I forgot what that super intensity was about. You don't worry about that. You're supposed to let it go. Once you come back to regular intensity, you let it go. And like momentum, it's working on you, even though you're not focused on it anymore. This is very true. On my 60th birthday, August 19th, I got this very unexpected blessing from Ram Maharshi. And it was so powerful. I was just in tears. It just shook me up to the core. It went all through it to the core of my being. And all day long, I was really shaken up by it. And even the next day a little bit, it was very profound. But then I just let it be. I trusted it. And ever since then, I've noticed the breakthroughs into super intensity are more and more and more profound. There's no question. So I trusted that this blessing is working within me. And I feel like now getting closer and closer to like feeling comfortable with Ram Maharshi, that perspective. It's like, oh, wow, yeah. So it does work, even though, so the trouble, what we do is when we're just normal functioning, we don't struggle trying to remember, now, okay, now what was it that I was thinking about? This is a no-no. You just trust that you did get to it. And then you realize, okay, now I need to function normal intensity, and I can't integrate the two. Do not try to integrate the two. Now, if you practice every day, this is no problem, right? Because you know I'll be getting back to it and better. It gets better and better and better. It's as soon as you fixate and try to structure what you experienced, then you'll be stuck on that. You'll try to reach that next time. So don't try to label it, describe it, fixate on it, because what I've found is it always gets better. It always gets better. So I just go with an open mind. I don't know what I'm going to experience today when I practice sitting quietly, committed to whatever happens. I will take no action. I will just continue to sit here quietly. I will not use this to motivate any sort of action. Whatever arises, I will not use it to motivate any sort of action, because it's super intensity. And as soon as we try to put that back into regular intensity for some action, we'll get confused. We won't know what to do. We'll get overheated, so to speak. So I'm committed to no action at all. I'm just sitting here committed to absolutely no action, no planning, no scheming, no strategizing, no projecting. I'm going to do this. This means I can do this or that. No, you're just going to sit here committed to no action. And that allows then the intensity to rise, and you're committed to full stop and the wow, to allow it to settle down without trying to grasp it. Don't try to grasp it. Let it go. Stay ungrasping. Let it come. Let it go. And so how do you do this? You might say this is amazing. Well, the answer is everyday practice is how you do it, because you have confidence that tomorrow will come and I'll practice again in the next day. And these things, whatever it is that was so important, is certain to emerge in an even clearer way for me. So I don't need to worry about grasping it today, right now. I'll just let it simmer within me. Just let it simmer. That's all. So the ones who practice every day have the utmost leverage and advantage. And you cannot even compare this with those who don't practice every day. It's apples and oranges. There's no comparison. There's no purpose of comparing it at all. Because one, practicing every day, you trust it, and you're able then to release the highs, release them without struggling. Clear mind, you're able to function clearly in the world in just regular intensity. You're not jittery about, oh my gosh, I just had this great insight and I don't know what to do about it. Whether to... No, what to do about it is next day you'll practice again. That's what you do about it. So you use it as motivation to make sure you practice the next day also. Okay? That's how you use it. And it gets better and better and better and better and better like this. Now I'm very shaken up from the meditation yet last night and this morning. So I have to practice not remembering what it was. Don't worry about what it was. Just calm down into normal intensity here. Have to function today. Now, I made a mistake yesterday. Okay. I have to develop some better habits in terms of I was taping, and it was so intense, the taping, that I got into my vehicle and I immediately let try I left. But I wasn't driving well. And so what I did wrong was, once I go through this intensity of taping, you get to the vehicle, what you do is you clean up, you know, you calm down, you drink some fluids, you eat something, you stretch a little bit, and you spend time just sitting there and calming down. I didn't give myself a chance to calm down. Meanwhile, I got a phone call and I said I'd come right home. So I didn't take, I should have taken at least 10 minutes. 10 minutes, don't drive. Once you get to your vehicle, don't drive for 10 minutes. So you get back into this normal intensity zone. So it's very important that you allow yourself to calm down. Now, if you're already driving and you go into this high, which I many times I have, you're already in the zone of driving. So you're okay, actually. It's the transition when you're not on the road yet. And if you're coming down off a really tremendous high, you need to be with your vehicle and calm down and get into this driving mode or whatever you're doing. So take about 10 minutes to transition. And I was so excited and from the taping, it was so amazing. I rushed too much, rushed too much. Not good. I got a little reminder that you got to watch yourself here. So it requires patience, slowing down to go faster. And if you want to go faster on the path, slow down. Because this enables you then to get into the super intensity, super positivity, super intensity, more and more and more. And that's how you go faster. But you have to be patient to then slow down, allow yourself to slow down, get back into normal intensity. And don't try to integrate the two. Okay, this is a huge mistake that I see many making. A delusion is delusion, non-delusion is non-delusion. Okay? Delusion's interesting to visit. You wouldn't want to stay in it. Okay? So it is what it is. Don't try to do anything with it or about it or integrate it. Then that gets you really confused. It's like trying to integrate normal intensity and super intensity, trying to integrate truth and lies. And this then overcooks your regular intensity, becomes too active. You're trying to be horizontally super active instead of shifting to the vertical. Super intensity is like going vertical. And normal intensity is going horizontal. But normal intensity can be speeded up. So you can speed up normal intensity, which is what the world's doing now. But that just makes things worse because you get more distracted from your practicing. So we're not trying to speed up the world, speed up normal intensity. In fact, it's better if a slow-paced life is better for us. So all this progress in the world, is this positive? No, it's not. It's negative. It's very negative. So much success in the past in slow-paced civilizations, spiritual success, so much success, because it was easy for them to go into this higher super intensity and then reintegrate that, not sorry, to not reintegrate, to transition from the super intensity back to normal intensity, because the normal intensity was calm, slow paced. I say, okay, you know, there's no cars, no technology, nothing. You had to do real fast. You know, you're watching your crops grow. So you could meditate for, you know, 8 hours a day or something. And I mean, this is really helpful. But in today's world of everything being speeded up faster and faster and faster, especially like here in the Silicon Valley, it's just insanely difficult. Then this requires, you know, very much determination. But the truth is, even in those slower paced areas, all the relatives, all the friends, they want you to come over and, you know, come over and, you know, celebrate this festival, celebrate our birthday, celebrate this. So there's always demands on you, right? Always, always, always. If you want to stay busy, you'll stay busy. And people, normal intensity, we stay busy to avoid super intensity. We claim, no, 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 we don't need super intensity. We're very intensely busy. But they're only busy in a horizontal way with the normal intensity. So this everyday practicing, this is what all the teachers recommend. And I've certainly done this, and I certainly recommend it. It gives you the leverage you need of confidence and trust, so that you can easily get back into the flow of normal intensity by just accepting that, yeah, okay, I had a very profound, I really got knocked out by super intensity. Okay, I'll be knocked out tomorrow too, so I don't need to obsess about what happened. I don't need to obsess about, I had some experience. I don't need to obsess about it. I had some experience. Great. Let it go. Okay. I'll have an experience tomorrow also. And just so one day at a time, no problem. I got my bell extra rung last couple days. But again, I'm not trying to think. I don't want to think about it. Try to call to mind what it was, because I'm in the wow. You see, so you're in the wow. You're coming down off that. You just, but you don't try to force it. Don't try to throw yourself into like undertakings and distractions, because you will then over-identify with those distractions. It's very dangerous. Whatever activity you get into to try to get back in the normal flow of intensity, If you jump into that instead of the wow, you become fixated on those situations, sex, drugs, rock and roll, food, all this stuff. You say, oh yeah, I need to get back in the normal flow of the flesh and the world and stuff. So let me jump into this. Okay. Let me look at a baseball game. Oh, then this becomes like a drug for you, and you become attached to it, fixated on it, and you'll do that all the time. It's addiction. So, full stop in the wow, it evaporates all addictions in the world. And this is not an addiction, it's a skillful means, truly effective skillful means. The others are not. So, the other stuff, we're trying to get back into normal intensity and grip a hold of it, you know, and feel that. So, okay, well, how can I have normal intensity yet feel real intense for me? So you get into these fixations. You watch football on Saturday, Sunday or something, right? Or soccer or whatever you do. Have a big meal. Drink some alcohol. Get drunk. Drink some caffeine, something. So you're trying to match the intensity of super intensity, so it feels like, you know, you feel like... more a transition there, Very bad, very bad. This is great mistakes that we make here. So to avoid all of those addictions, you practice full stop in the wow here. And all those addictions, you realize, I don't need them. I have the skillful means. I know how to do it. I know how to do it. That other stuff comes with massive baggage and addictions and fixations and troubles and stuff. Full stop in the wow, there's no troubles. No baggage comes with it. No baggage comes with it. All you have to do is sit here quietly, okay? And then as you go about your life after that, you realize, I don't need these addictions. I don't need this stuff, that all the stuff that people are using. I don't need any of that. Because everyone's worried, like, oh my gosh, if I have some super intensity, how will I get back to the world? How can I do it? Oh, let me get addicted to this. Let me get addicted to this. This helps me. It's not, that stuff is not super intensity, like drugs. It's not super intensity. It's not. It's a lot of intensity. It's a super amount of intensity, but it's not super intensity, okay? As I say, it's a lot of intensity, abundance of intensity. But that is not the same as super intensity. Apples and oranges. So we get addicted to lots of intensity in all sorts of different ways. Our lives are full of lots of intensity. The sex, the drugs, the rock and roll, okay, of it all. Our lives, lots of intensity. But none of that is super intensity. So the goal is super intensity, not lots of intensity. It's like drinking a lot of vanilla milkshakes. You know, every day I'm drinking milkshakes. Wow, I'm really, it's a super amount of milkshakes, of vanilla milkshakes. But what you really want is the chocolate milkshake. Okay, and so it doesn't matter how many vanilla milkshakes you drink. That's never going to be a chocolate milkshake. And you mix the two together, it's still, you know, I can't, then you get real confused. Oh, where is this, and the bill and the chocolate? Now you want that rich chocolate milkshake. Super intense, rich chocolate milkshake. I better not talk about that too much. I might want to get one. I've stopped the chocolate. Well, I have chocolate flavored protein powder, which is enough. I did this smoothie today. I haven't tried this. Got this Bolt House, I think it's called. Greens, you know, greens in a bottle sort of thing with kale and broccoli and romaine lettuce or something. It says you drink, you know, a cup of it and that gives you all these vegetables. So I drank that, but then I poured in some vanilla protein drink and then some chocolate protein powder, mixed it together, and a banana. It tastes pretty good, but it's like drinking your vegetables. Drink your vegetables. Because I'm not eating many vegetables anymore. Not eating much solid food. Mostly fruits. So I got to get some vegetables somehow. But I snack on it. If there's some around, I'll snack on some vegetables. Like broccoli's always good. But drinking your vegetables, you got to flavor it up a little bit. You can do it like once or twice, but then, you know, I lose the habit, like kale smoothies. I can do it, but then I stop the habit because it just, it's a little too much. So you've got to flavor somehow, flavor it. So now if you have a difficult time transitioning from super intensity to intensity, then it's going to feel too ragged for you and you'll quit. So I had a very difficult time because nobody was teaching full stop on the wow. Nobody explained it to me. No matter how many spiritual books I read, I never got, you know, or understood how do I manage my success here, really? You know, people just say, well, you need to meditate, be quiet, still. But what do you, for what? I mean, where's the context? So I had to figure it all out myself and understand what's really going on. It took decades. So, you know, a guru could explain this to you. I didn't have a guru. I had the Holy Spirit. It's just gradually I figured it out. This is the most important advice. All this pop spirituality is, sometimes I think it's worse than useless, you know. It actually has a negative effect. It can. You get out of what you put into it. But you have to understand the context of this. And the whole context of spiritual path is to continuously, every day, get more and more used to the super intensity of truth. And in order to do that, you have to become expert at smoothing your way back into normal intensity. You have to become an expert at that. Now, this is what should be focused on. And this is what our talk should be about, is how do you become an expert in this. You have to be like a virtuoso. You practice every day, you'll get very good at it. Now, you won't be perfect at it. I struggled this morning, full stop in the well. I had troubles. It was so intense. Super intense, super intense, super intense. And you might say, well, what was super intense? Well, the recognitions that I had were super intense. What recognitions? Well, I don't remember. See, I don't remember. I'm not trying to recall them. I'm now in the wow mode. But you see, here, I actually had the super intensity. Whereas in the world with sex, drugs, rock and roll, and all of that, you don't have the super intensity. You just have intensity, a lot of intensity, not super intensity. So transitioning out of that back to normalcy is not the same thing at all. It's not the same thing. You don't become an expert that way. You do not. In hindsight, in the world, just shows this very clearly. Those who've tried to make that happen, they just have just stalled out, just haven't gotten anywhere. Return ticket. So you don't want to hang out with those kind of companions, those kind of influences, and any of the programs, entertainment, and diversions that any of those influences produce, whether it be, you know, television and movies, magazines, books, internet, radio, productions of this and that, and concert, you know, you name it, and music, entertainments of all kinds. You don't want to hang out with that. That is not super intensity. No music is super intensity. No entertainment. Nothing comes from the world as super intensity. Super intensity arises from within you when you're committed to full stop on the wow, so you can transition back to normalcy of regular intensity. When you're committed to that, really committed, you will find insights arising from within your own mind that will just really be quite astonishing for you. And I took the most in super intense step I've ever taken last night in my taping of finally took the plunge because I had enough confidence that I'll be able to function, transition back to normal functioning through the wow. So I'm working on this. And boy, did I get my bell rung. But I'm not going to try to bring it back. Don't revisit it. This is very important when you're transitioning back into normal intensity. Don't try to revisit the super intensity. Don't try to revisit. You did it. You were successful. So pat yourself on the back, and now it's time to transition back to normal intensity, but not into a lot of normal intensity. Okay? So if you don't calm down enough, settle down enough, you will transition into too much intensity to try to match the vibes of super intensity that are still reverberating. You'll try to match that, and you'll have too much intensity. So we just let it settle down, let it keep smoothing out. Don't try to do too much. Keep your life simple, keep things simple. And before you know it, you say, "Oh, okay, I'm back in the world again in terms of my intensity. Everything settled down." You'll just feel it. Some moment you just feel, "Oh, okay." You'll feel this moment where suddenly you kind of feel like, "Oh, like I'm back asleep again in the world." I was awake, but now I'm back asleep again. Oh, okay, I'm used to this. You just feel that. It's amazing. And suddenly you're just, you're functioning just like you normally function. But you can't force that. Cannot force it. So you need patience. You have to have patience with this practicing. So when you're calming down, the key is full stop in the wow. You do not plan or anticipate or think about what you're going to do. Immediately, that'll start over stimulating your imagination in terms of doing stuff, and you'll start to get nervous. You do not plan or think about what am I going to do. Your business right now is letting everything settle down. Don't stir it up. So this practice is the most essential habit there is. If you avoid this practice, you will get a return ticket to the realm, to coming and going. In fact, you'll never leave it. You won't leave it. You'll go with dying into, and then you'll be arriving in the afterlife, and then you'll leave the afterlife and arrive in another more physical life. And then you'll just keep doing that, coming and going, coming and going, coming and going. That's all that will happen for you. And all the miseries of that. No exceptions. You never get lucky. So I lead a super simple life in terms of socialization. No socialization. Going places, no going places. Visiting, no visiting. I let those who are close to me, they want to visit their friends. They visit their friends. I don't go along with them. Talk on the phone. Let them talk on the phone. I don't pay attention. I mind my own business. They mind their own business. And because nothing should get in the way of your everyday practice. And you stay humble, because I'm very humbled by this latest experience. It just shook my psyche up completely. It's still shaking. I'll never be the same. So it's like you don't brag to those around you about, oh yeah, I'm doing this. Yeah, I had a great meditation today. All that. Now you don't say anything about it. I don't say anything about it. Well, I do tape here to pass this information on. You just quietly go about your business. That's all. And when you're normal functioning in the world, normal, you're just an average Joe or Jane, you know, you're just nothing important, nothing special. You're not trying for a great amount of intensity. And you're not trying for a super small amount of intensity either. So you're not trying to make a point. You just do what the Holy Spirit suggests you do. But you're not... If you're feeling expansive, then you feel do something expansive. If you're not feeling expansive, then you're not feeling doing something expansive. You're not... You're just... So you're not trying to... You're trying to do low intensity. That in itself is very intense in this world, isn't it? Just like it's trying to do a whole lot of intensity... is intense, trying to do a whole lot of non-intensity can also be intense. So you don't try to force it. Like if I tape, oh, it's fun, having fun, and I feel like I can do some of this, like some of these short videos. Okay, I'm in the mood for that. And then drop it if I'm not in the mood for it. So don't try to be artificial in your just normal life. Just you know, be who you are in your normal life, whatever that is. It's okay, because it's the practicing of super intensity that's important. Your normal intensity life doesn't matter, okay? As long as you just stay in the flow of it, okay? And when you practice every day, you'll understand that this is what it's really about. And so my life is not important in terms of, do I need to accomplish something or do I need to not accomplish something? Either way, it's not important. So if I want to do something, I'll do it. If I don't want to do something, I won't do it. Either way is okay. Just don't try to get a super intense experience through your normal life. Like someone's riding a motorcycle, they ride on weekends, they go, you know, all these places and stuff. Okay, that's just a lot of intensity. There's no super intensity to that. A lot of intensity. For me, I say, that's just not in the flow of my life. If it was, okay, fine. It would still be the same. Just a lot of intensity, that's it. Some people like that, a lot of intensity. That's okay. Just stay in the flow of your life, the way your personality is. Don't try and manipulate your life somehow too much, you know. Just let it be the way that it is. Don't worry about it. It's not important. What's important is practicing every day. If you don't do that, you've led a wasted life. There's always intensity. You can always generate intensity or generate not so much intensity. You can live a jet-setting lifestyle, or you can be, you know, a housewife for your whole life. But even that, then you can be all sorts of intensity with children and grandchildren and friends and going here and vacations. Or you can just be like a just kind of a blah life, you know, I'm just living in by myself somewhere. I got no friends. I don't do many things. I'm just hanging out in the house. You can live that sort of life. That's actually, I would say, a more fortunate life, actually. If your life's just blah, that's great. Very fortunate. Don't try to force it into not being blah too much. Make it work for you. Make it work for you. I'll say, oh great, I can practice more. I can really get my bell rung. I really get shocked, you know, by super intensity. Knocked out. Really get knocked out by it. Super intensity. Which is truth, truth. Really knocked out. And then I'm able to come back down from that. And there's not all these demands on me from all different directions. So it's a lot safer. It's a lot safer. So it's very fortunate. Some of the lives that people think are so unfortunate are actually very fortunate. I have a very fortunate life now, leading to endless fortune, actually. It's just, there's so little demands on me that I feel safe that I can do this, and I know there's not going to be a lot of demands. There'll be maybe one or two here or there, but other than that, no. It's like, you know, living in a cave. You know, that's what those who were successful in the past, they often lived in caves and no demands, and they could practice this, going to the super intensity and then getting going out of that, and then going back into it, and then coming out, and then going back into it, and get more and more used to that super intensity. There's no demand, so that they could be in the wow. You know, maybe it takes them all day long. They're just kind of shaken from what they experienced. That's okay. Nobody's demanding for them to build a bridge. So have your little cave somewhere. Maybe your house is your cave, your garden, someplace. Where I have this perfect little cave that God gave me here. It's amazing. It's like perfect. Just have a little bench. I just have a bench with some cushions. Just sit on the bench here. Sit on a bench. It's a comfortable bench. And God, the Holy Spirit helped me set all this up. Some people made some suggestions like, hey, why don't you clean this area up? I said, huh? Because it was just like totally unusable before. So ultimately, I did. I put some stone on the floor. Floor used to be just dirt. And it's turned out to be like the best thing I've ever did. And it's like about, you know, like about wide. It's about 6-7 feet wide, maybe by about 6 feet deep. Yeah, maybe like 7 by 7. 6 by 6 area, 7 by 7 area. And so it's just a little space here, just enough. You make it 8 feet by 6 feet, something like that. 8 feet by 7 feet, 8 feet by 7 feet. Yeah, around those dimensions, not too cramped. It's just enough, like a cave, kind of. Just enough space here. Maybe I spent time in caves in a previous life. That's why I feel comfortable here. But it actually opens up to the world here. It's open. It's kind of closed on one side, and on this side and this side, it's open. So there's a spaciousness here. But it's covered, which is nice. I find if you're out like in the sun, it doesn't work as well. I think it's a lot better to have an awning or a covering over where you're sitting. This is what I have experienced. But it's outside. I like that. I used to do it inside for maybe 30 years inside. Just sit in my room. But this works very, very well. So if you have a cave that looks out on some vista or looks out in the world, and it's covered on top and on the sides, and then it looks out, that's probably the best. That's probably the best. So the kids are doing something in the street. But do I get up and look? No, I'm in full stop in the wow mode. You don't get up and look. You let the world pass you by when you're in this full stop in the wow mode. It doesn't matter what's happening in the news. It doesn't matter what whatever's going on. You're not paying attention. You're not looking at it. So don't try to force stillness on it. Let it just settle down by itself. We're not trying to still our minds or force stillness or do something to be quiet. We're just naturally allowing it to settle. Settle down. Don't let the mind wander. How quickly the mind wanders, right? Starts thinking about this, and it's often, where are you going? What do you mean? What are you doing? Stay right here. So the idea of staying right here is you're just sitting here in your cave. That's where you are. Don't let your mind start thinking that you're somewhere in the past, traipsing through the Himalaya Mountains in a festival or something or this and this. No, you're right here, right now, here. You're right here, right now. And, you know, you're going to need to get up, drive somewhere, function here. Super positive, the super intensity. It's not some spiritual fantasy or some, you're just in a reverie of going somewhere and doing something. No, 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 it's not like that. It has nothing historic about it at all. It's not time-based at all. So, Buddha experiencing the super intensity of super positivity, that wasn't time based. He didn't say, "Oh, I'm having this here in this millennium, and everybody, I want all the rest of you when you know, thousands of years from now to relate back to when I was here in this time in the world." No, that's time based. What Buddha's realizing is this experiencing this that which is not time based at all. So that which is not time based, it must be the same right now, right? So, wherever you are, whatever center you're in, right where you are, this super positivity, super intensity, which is not time-based, you can experience that just the same as anyone else has experienced it anywhere else. I don't care how long ago it was or how far in the future it will be. It's the same. It's the same. It's not touched by time at all. So you don't have to go back to Buddha's time. I got to go back there to get the purity of it because it's so impure right now. No, there's no such thing as impurity. That which is not time-based is not corrupted by time. Time only corrupts time. Illusions only corrupt illusions. What is beyond illusions and time is not corrupted at all. Buddha mind now is the same as Buddha mind thousands of years ago, the same as it will be thousands of years in the future. No difference. All these epochs and eras of time don't have any effect upon it. Zero effect upon it. And this is what we glimpse, we realize, we get glimpses of this and say, oh my gosh, very shocking. Very shocking to us. Surprisingly shocking. So I say this to everyone. You must practice in this way because you underestimate the shock that it has upon you. Greatly underestimate it. So you have to prepare as if you're going to be really shocked by what you experience. This is why full stop and the wow is designed to handle being really shocked by super positivity, super intensity, be really shocked by it. It's designed for that. And so as you insist on this full stop and the wow, this way of calming down, settling down, then this enables you to actually experience this shock, really get knocked out. Nothing that's ever happened in this illusion, dream of time, has had any effect at all. None. Zero. And experiencing this, accepting it, acceptance leads to this experiencing feeling, not a deep, clear experiencing so much, but a shocking, like shock of recognition. It's like, it really shakes up the whole landscape of your expectations. So these glimpses of the timeless super intensity, super positivity, no matter how it presents, really shakes up the personality, the psyche, our belief system. It really shakes it up. It's not a joking matter. You have to take it very seriously in terms of discipline. You got to give it some time to settle down. Nothing else you can do. When it's really shaken up like this, it takes a while for you to settle down, calm down. If you saw some yogi flying through the air right in front of you, literally, you know what? You'd be pretty shaken up about that, right? People will say, oh, no, no problem. No, if you saw someone levitate right in front of you, you know, you would be very shaken up later. Initially, you might say, oh, wow, really excited, super intense. Later on, your whole psyche say, wait a minute, how's that possible? I don't understand. How can I get that? You know, how can I integrate this? How can I, you know? So if you don't know how to avoid all that, then you don't want to see someone levitating. You don't want to see that stuff. You'll avoid it. Those are just some examples, but crass examples, you know, so you can easy to relate in some way. But the inner experiences that are more powerful than that, way more powerful. In terms of devastating, you know, our expectations for the future, for what we're doing, evolving, success, struggling, striving, all that stuff. You just say, whoa. It's all much ado about nothing. So mental health is something you have to work at. Mental health is to progressively get more and more familiar with truth. But each step you take, like this one, it puts a strain on you. But it's like working out. You don't get stronger unless you work out. I worked out a little last night. Probably need to work out a little today too. Maybe more than a little. You need to be in the mood to do it, right? Because you know, you're going to feel tired. The next day you're going to feel sore. It's you feel it, you feel it. So it's amazing. A lot of people work out every day and they feel it, right? Same thing with this full stop in the wild practice. You feel it. So it's very similar to working out every day. The principle is, the actual experience is super intensity instead of the intensity of working out. A lot of people substitute physical workouts for super intensity. But when you do this practice every day, you can also work out physically if that's what you like doing. Sure. If that's your normal thing. Just don't make it a substitute. Don't try to make it a substitute. That's when you become fixated and go overboard. Just say nothing can substitute for this practice, which is true. Nothing can substitute for it. So many different ways are used to try to substitute for it. This is what I've seen. Massive amounts of different ways. Because we're afraid of the intensity. Because we don't have the skills set to deal with it. It's like skateboarders. I say, how do they do that stuff? And they always say, you know, if you just practice it and you get the hang of it becomes second nature to you. I mean, it's just natural to us now. It's just natural. So it's not like going off curbs. I was watching videos of how to go off curbs. And, you know, it's just like, huh? It's as easy as easy. You just ride off the curb. He says, yeah, but. He said, yeah, when you first do it, it's like freak out. You're so scared, everything. He says, but once you get the hang of it and do it over and over, then you don't even think about it. It's just automatic. It's easy. That's what they say. I've still not done anything like that. I've not even gone over any cracks. You know, there's I got some steps I got to take. That's for sure. But it's something that kids could do easily. They're not afraid of falling. Keep in mind that as your toddler, you fall all the time. Crawling, toddling, young. You fall so many times. You're so used to actually taking a spill. They just take a spill, like, whoa, get up, brush themselves off, then right back on the board again. For me, though, I don't want to take a spill. I already took one. That's enough. But the way they do stuff is just, you know, it's amazing. It's amazing. It's very much a kid's thing. They're not afraid to get airborne and then, like, hope they land on the board. If they don't land on it, oh well. You know, in the bushes, oh well. That was fun. That's part of it, I guess. I think that's part of the allure for kids. Is they're coming, growing up towards adulthood, where adults, they never fall, right? But they're coming from a time where they're falling and tumbling all the time, growing up, right? Whoa, dude, trying this, I fell, I lost my balance. So they're used to that. And they don't really want to grow up to be these adults, these robotic adults who, you know, their parents never stumble or fall or do any of this stuff. And they kind of think that's really weird. I don't know if I really want to be that way. So skateboarding gives them like this transitional thing to give an excuse, you know, to keep falling and keep doing these things that they do. Keep being a kid, actually. That's why they do all these tricks, so they keep falling. Because, you know, kids, all they're playing is the way they play. They're just so 360 degree flexible and active. And they trip, they fall, they tumble, and oh, get dirty and scraped and all this stuff. But that's like exciting for them, you know, they enjoy that. So skateboarding gives them a great excuse to be falling all over the place. And certainly the tricks do. Yeah, it's amazing the tumbles you see. Go to a skate park, the kids are tumbling all over the place, falling all over the place. Succeeding too a lot, but they're also taking some big spills. Now I thought maybe I could take some of those spills. Well, not exactly. Not like when you're weigh 50 pounds. But they all do grow up, right? I meet so many people. They say, you skate? No, I used to. How long has it been? Oh, it's been a while. So they all stop. Virtually all stop. Because the falls get too painful as you get older, right? So of course you're gonna stop. You say, ah, that's a little too dangerous. Ah, that's like, you hear guys who used to be really pro, top pros. You do that anymore? No, I don't do that anymore. Nah, it's too dangerous for me. So it's very depressing, isn't it, to lose that. They learn how to. The worst thing is having both your feet go out from underneath you up in the air like that. That's what happened to me. That's the worst. As long as you have one, at least one foot somehow somewhat centered over one foot, you're okay. It's when both feet go out from underneath you quickly, poof, because you can't get your feet back down to break your fall. You know, so it's just all going to be on your core body. So I have to focus on avoiding that. So we're just cooling out here. You see, this is a cool down period. So it's absolutely essential. The experience I just went through last night is the capacity to practice the way we're practicing here. Absolutely essential. I can tell you this now. This is why I advocate this so strongly. You will not be able to handle that sort of experience unless you're very confident and very skilled and practiced in full stop and the wow. Call it what you want throughout history. That those who succeeded had to have be very, very skillful at this, very have great confidence and trust that I can calm down from this. I know how to do this. And have to. You have to. Because the temptation was extreme to jump into thinking and wow, just had to stay out of it. If I wasn't adept at this, most definitely, I would have gotten, my mind would have gone into been pulled gradually towards turmoil of trying to figure this out, trying to figure this out, this and that, and just stay out of it, just let it be. So the temptation was very, very strong, and that's why those who have been through it tell us then that, the quote unquote meditation, contemplation, but this really, this practice is all important. Have to make it a habit and get really good at it. The better you get at it, the clearer your insight will be. I don't want to go back and revisit it because it stirs it up again, you know. So, see, if I prove that I can transition back to just normal functioning, if I prove that to myself, then I won't be afraid to do it again. You see how this works in our favor? I'll say, oh, yeah, I did that. I'm okay. I feel okay. I feel functioning normal. So, I can do it again. Not a problem. And the mind will get into all these projects. Oh God, I see a project here. I see a project here. I can do this here. I can do that here. This here. This here. And then each project has side projects. Okay, a lot of side projects here. A lot of side projects over here. And before you know it, it's just like you're overwhelmed. You overwhelm yourself. So you must say, just no projects for now. Don't even think about it. At some point, you might do something, okay? But don't think about it. Don't think about it ahead of time, really. When you're calm, relaxed, then you'll see, oh, I can do this. It'll be smooth and easy. But when you're in this wild, don't think about any projects. Don't think about what you could do or what you're going to do next. Takes the pressure off. And don't think about what was the insight that I had that led to all this intensity. You had it. So, you know, that's what's important. You got to it. You'll get to it again. At some point, once you calm down and prove to yourself, okay, I can handle this. I can still function here just fine. Prove to yourself this. And then you'll say, okay. At some point, you'll get back to it again. The easier you make it on yourself, the easier it is to get back to it. Like, should I go ride my skateboard now? No, because I'm too much in the wow right now to do that. Maybe later today, right? Maybe later, not right now. So you know, you can't be a normal champion of this or this or that, because you say, I can't do it right now because I'm too much wow what's going on. So I can't really practice my skateboard now. They say practice, practice, practice. Well, I'm not going to do it now because I'm coming down off the super intensity. It's not the right thing to do. You don't want to try and do something like that. And I don't really want to talk with people at this point, no. Dialogues and stuff, no. Answering questions, responding to this and that. No, stay off Facebook for right now. And like I said, when it settles down, you will just immediately feel, oh, okay, now I can do this, okay. But don't try to force it. It will arrive. But you may not be a world beater in terms of success because you think, well, if I just forced it, drank some coffee, got going, I'd be much more productive, you know. That kind of thing. Again, don't try to be a world beater in your life. If being productive is your normal thing, then just be normal like that. I produce a lot of videos. It just gives me something to do. I don't have anything else to do. But right now, if I tried to do a video, it wouldn't turn out well. Wouldn't turn out well. No. It'd be forced. I don't feel. The dust hasn't settled. It just. So it's how you handle after the great insights that you have, the breakthroughs. That's what's important. Because just seeing it once isn't enough. You have to see it again and again and again and again and again in different angles. Everyday breakthroughs, everyday breakthroughs. You just have to get more and more and more used to it. So you may not be able to build a great big career and a great big life resume and all those kinds of things. It doesn't matter, because if you don't practice effectively, you'll be coming back here again. Start over from scratch, so to speak. You'll still have your habits, but you will find that what worked in the previous life may not work in this life at all. And you get super frustrated. Especially if you made a name for yourself, like which I did my previous life. And so my name worked for me. It opened all doors. Everybody knew who I was. I was unmistakable. Everybody knew. And so if I'm there, oh, you know. And how can we help you? What can we do for you? Oh, we're so wonderful that you're here, you know. So you have this name. And that's what works. Now, returning to this world again, nobody knew who I was. Nobody, I didn't have any name at all for myself. So I'm walking around expecting all these doors to open for me, and nobody does anything. And it just caused me the most terrible problems of frustration and despair. And because my success was built upon that I had this tremendous name recognition. That was the most important thing. And how that happened was, you know, very fortuitous, or in hindsight, maybe it wasn't so fortuitous, but I was unknown, and then someone who's very high position in society discovered me. Because I had talent that they liked the talent, but they had a tremendous circle of high friends in the arts, and so they, you know, they really were looked as very prominent. And then they introduced me to all their friends and to the high society and to all the important people, and wrote about me and everything. And so I became like began to become really well known in powerful circles, because my mentor, you know, was seeing to it. He made a point of introducing me and telling all his friends, hey, look, you know, this is, you have to listen to this one. This one, it really is going to keep the high arts, you know, flowing through your life. Because people in the high arts, they're addicted to it. So what happened was, I was introduced as the next, you know, drug pusher of music. Basically, that's what it is. It's a drug. Here's the next super drug pusher is going to give you really good stuff. And so all the addicts said, oh my gosh, that's great. You know, and so I became so well known, and throughout my life I became, you know, like an icon. So everybody knew who I was. Society, everybody. I walk down the street, every single person, oh, they know, oh, that's, you know, so-and-so walking down the street. Oh, wow. Wow. You know, autographs, all this stuff. I was hounded by autograph seekers, which I didn't like. I became a recluse. I escaped the autograph seekers, you know. They just wanted to take, you know, like a selfie with me, so to speak, right? I was here with, this super icon, well-known icon. So it's so easy. You know, you walk into a restaurant, boom, best table. You go anywhere. Everybody is eager to serve you and make things happen. And it's like, do you mind? Could I have this happen? Of course, of course. So I you know, could pretty much get any position I wanted, any job I wanted. I kind of like to, you know, I'd like to, if you, could you invite me here to, you know, do this for you? And of course, of course, of course, we'll make it happen, don't worry. Because it's very prestigious, you know, to have some name person. Names are so strong. If you have a name, everybody wants you because it pulls a crowd. You understand this? Like if like Brian Wilson of the Beach Boys said, you know, he goes to some venue and says, you know, I kind of like to like throw a concert here sometime. They're going to say, of course, Mr. Wilson, of course. When would you like to do it? You know, well, we'll set it all up. And then advertise, Brian Wilson coming, you know. And then everybody said, oh my God, Brian Wilson, the Beach Boys is going to be there. It's just, oh my gosh, I've got to go. I got to go. I might even get to meet him. You know, are you kidding me? Get to meet Brian Wilson. Now, I might even go if I get to meet Brian Wilson and tell you the truth. I mean, if I had a chance to meet Brian Wilson, I probably would. Okay, I don't know if I could resist that. That would be a tough one. out of all the people in the world, I think that'd probably be the toughest one for me to say, nah, don't need to. If he was there, I might want to go up and shake his hand or something. He probably wouldn't know who the heck I was. Doesn't matter, but they'd kind of be like, ah. Anyway, the name pulls people. Okay, so once you get a name, you feel like everybody's on your side. You can do no wrong. This is what happened with me in my life just previous to this one. I had this super name. And so, you know, if I'm showing up at some venue, some concerts, this and that, poof, that gets advertised, and wow, you know, public comes, people come, everybody wants to be somebody. They all want to be with somebody that has a name, you see, because this is what they want too. Because they realize once you have a name, you know, like, you know, everything seems to go easy for you, right? Well, on the surface. So they think if they're seen with a name, that'll help them get a name. You understand that? So you have power over society. That's what I had. I had tremendous power over culture and society because of the name I made for myself through because I was introduced in the right, through the right channels. I knew the right people. It was just fortunate in that way. Someone discovered me. The right person discovered me. And then you ended up with all this leverage over culture. Because everybody wants to be kings wanted to be seen with me. The rulers, you know, presidents, everybody wanted to be seen with me. It's very prestigious for them. Like, I'm a patron of the arts, the high arts. You know, yeah, I'm sophisticated enough in the high arts to be seen with this, you know, great icon. And so I'm well-rounded. You know, I'm a great well-rounded person, a Renaissance person. You know, and then this gives them appeal to the public. And they, you know, get stay in power. They get the people say, oh, we can trust this guy. You know, he know he look who he associates with this one. You know, this is how it works. If you're really up there in culture, you know, the politicians come, you know, begging for a picture with you. They invite you. I was invited into all the most wealthy, you know, palaces in Europe. I hung out with the wealthiest people in Europe, actually, a lot of times. I did left them, you know. I said, oh, I gotta do other stuff. But they said, please come to our house, you know. Then they invite all their friends and, you know, play the piano, you know, oh, the little concert. Oh, my, and the friends just, oh my God, you're able to get him to come? That's unbelievable, man. We're like, you know, super rich, but we can't get him to come to our palace. And so you get this enormous prestige, you know. So that's the kind of power I had. And I could say, no, I'm not going, no, I can't attend you because I'm going to this other place. And they like, oh, gosh, if you only come to us, you know, he'll give you more money, you know, just whatever you want, because we've got even more prestige. So you get these people vying for you, wealthy people, you know, they're desperate to get more of a name because names are so important, aren't they? Once you get the big name, then, you know, I mean, you're like Elvis or something, you know. I mean, just here's Elvis. Oh, God, you know. But that wasn't high culture. We're talking about high culture. The wealthy people want to associate with you. So I found out how insecure and miserable wealthy people were. Yeah, it's a shock. And politicians and I found out, you know, how everything really is. How desperate and miserable everybody is by being able to associate with everybody like that. I mean, they're just, you know, using you, wanting to use you for their own, you know, aggrandizement. They didn't have any talent, but they wanted people to think they did. So if I was there, I had real talent because of my discipline and steady determination and avoiding distractions and stuff. So but they want other people to think that they had this natural great talent, you know. I don't even need to practice, you know. I got such great natural talent, you know, as they're busy, you know, trying to make their next, you know, $100 million. I say, well, you know, you need to actually practice, you know, 10 hours a day. Oh yeah, I don't have time, but you know, just hang out with me. Let people think that I'm just, you know, you think that I'm naturally talented in that way, and don't even need to practice, you know, like that. Like that. So again, and then going into this life, when you get reborn with a different name, different country, different place, nobody knows who you are, who you were in a previous life. And so again, I was so used to just everybody jumping, like, hey, can you help me? Hey, oh wow, we really want you to, you know. I was used to being invited everywhere, constantly. And nobody gave me any invitation anywhere here. Nobody had any idea who I was. It's like, and so I couldn't function. I didn't know what to do. I don't invite myself. I would do inviting myself somewhere. It's ridiculous. So I just was like a fish out of water. You see how bizarre the twists and turns of fate are, actually. You come back to this world, and but I had it especially bad because of having a big name. I just expected this is how it all works. This is how it all worked for me. Didn't work that way at all. So I was constantly astonished. I'm walking down the streets, there's nobody's paying me any attention to me at all. This is completely bizarre. It's totally weird. Wait for someone to invite me, and the wealthy people, they never completely ignore me. You have no idea who I am. And I was like, what's the matter with them? What's going on here? Don't they want me to hang out with them? And no, they don't. Huh? So your previous lives shock you in this one very badly because things don't go the way they used to go. But especially when you have a big name. If you have no big name at all, then you're just back of the world. So I just got to work, work and earn my way and just try to struggle to survive, and that's it. So you just keep doing that. But not to say if you have a really big name, you're used to having power over culture, being a culture maker, deciding, who do you favor? So this is how it was. This is the game in Europe was, it's who you decide to favor. You hang out with this group or this group here. Who do you lend your gravitas to? Who do you lend your weight to? So you're like a kingmaker, kind of. And so you're always thinking, okay, you have to be very aware of what trends do you want to support. So I was very much into that. So I started becoming very conscious of, okay, well, I've got so much influence. How do I use it? So this was what carried into this lifetime is like, I said, I really didn't, I feel I really didn't use my influence in the best way I could have. I wish I had used it better, especially in looking back when I was born here in America, and then discovering, finding out what had gone on with World War I and World War II, especially World War II in Germany. So it just blew my mind. And in Europe, I mean, the two wars in Europe, that just devastated me because I was trying to use my influence to help avoid that, and obviously didn't work. So I was very felt very guilty that I had not used my influence properly somehow. If I used it better way, maybe that wouldn't have happened. This is how I felt because I had so much influence. It seems like you never have enough influence here in the world, doesn't it? Doesn't matter how much influence you have. Can you really stop insanity from having its effects play out? But anyway, I became so conscious of how do you use influence in the right way? What's the truth? How do you help people really to avoid the hell? That, I mean, Europe's been through hell. I was a very big player in Europe. And so I really cared about Europe so much. And to find out when I came back that I passed away in the the late 1900s. To come back and to see the devastation and what they went had went what they went through, what was just devastated me. I was devastated along with them, really. I was so devastated by it. Said, how could we have done that? I mean, why couldn't you just listen to the music and be happy? Why couldn't you just Well, because the militaristic martial type of super dramatic music, the heroic music, all that stuff, gripped people. And I was trying to present music that made you more introspective and tried to help you move towards super intensity without trying to pull these themes in of conquest and dominance and drama and all this kind of stuff, the Sturm und Drang sort of stuff. I was very much tried to move away from that, help culture move away from that. So in this life, I'm trying to find out how do you use the influence when you have it? It's very important. And ultimately, you should use it to turn people towards right meditation, right contemplation, right spiritual efforts. Buddha, Dharma, Sangha. This is a way of saying it. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Music is not the answer, actually. This is what I bitterly discovered. I said, wow, well, how can I make a name for myself again? Because if music's not the answer, and that's what I'm such an expert in, how do I help out, have influence. The world needs the right influence, for sure. But I, how can I possibly make a name for myself in any other field? You know, this became a very troublesome, vexatious thing. I've got no name for myself in the spiritual field at all. But I turned to what I always turned to before, which is just determined, steady determination, effort. And I said, well, before some great cultural icon, you know, discovered me and felt that I had what it took to be, you know, help push the drugs of music forward. And so if I just steadily determine on the spiritual path and just work every day at it, eventually, you know, someone will notice and say, hey, this is someone who can help, you know, influence the world in a positive way, in a super positive way, super positive. So this is what has happened. This is what has happened. So now Longchenpa noticed me and said, hey, I love what I see here. Here's someone that actually practices. So the question is, you know, how do you use your influence to truly help out the most? And it's not through music. I've already learned the most bitter lesson through that. You know, Europe has been torn with so many wars. You want to avoid that happening again, right? So I wanted to avoid the destitution and the struggles. And and you want to use your influence and culturally to move people away from that. And then when it doesn't happen, you know, it's just like, wow. So you kind of have to use a long-term viewpoint. But music is not the answer. It's not the answer. That's just positivity, and you know, a lot of intensity. Just get a lot of intensity, a lot of not so much intensity. You play with intensity. It's just a music, just to play with intensity. At least music. On the level of where we're at, actually, it's just to play with intensity. It's not super intensity. It's not super positive. Because the one who is experiencing it comes and goes, is not stable. Stability is super positivity. The stability that we are that stability. There's no coming and going with our identity, what we are actually at all. That's just a dream identity that we're looking at, coming and going. The music that it inspires in, and ends up dispiriting it, and all of that, that's not the answer. The answer is to know, you know, who we are, what we are really. And I am that I am. I am what I am. As Ramana says, I. Not I am this, just I. I is I. It's not I this or I that, just I. Just I. It's weird. People still hear that when I used to be a musician or something when I was young, and they come to me and say, oh, can you still play piano? Can you do this? Can you play for me? Can you do something, music for me? Can you do, you know? It's like, oh, no, I don't even know how to play. I don't have any. Well, you used to have so many, you know, guitars, and you know, I don't have anything. You know, no, I don't have anything. They can't believe it. The musicians cannot believe it, that I am no longer a musician. They won't accept it. Because they're drug addicts. And the pusher man, I was like one of the top pusher mans ever. And I pushed out music for people, for addicts, drug addicts, music drug addicts. So when you're pushing out really good, high quality drugs, music drugs for people, for the addicts, you become very important to them. Really important. You're Mr. Big Stuff. right? You come to town, and all the addicts show up, and they come out of the woodwork. It's no fun having addicts after you because they want more. You know, hey, where's your latest production? You know, where's your latest this? Where's your latest that? It's never enough. So I had all these addicts, you know, a continent of addicts after me, wherever I went. They all came out of the woodwork. You know, maybe he's finally come up with the right stuff, you know, the right drug. It's just going to be perfect for me this time. And so this puts a lot of strain on me, you know, like, wow, I got to do something better. I got to represent reality better. How do you represent reality? How do you represent pure freedom? Whatever you do, it's not it, right? Whatever you do, it's never it, not even at all. So, you know, but there are ways of playing with it. I'm trying to play with it in some way to get you to practice, you know, to inspire you. Otherwise, you're in a world of trouble. You'll either be an addict or a drug pusher, you know. That's one or the other in this world. It's better to be an addict than a drug pusher, though, I'll tell you that. Because then when you get born again here and you're used to having that big name, but the music has changed, the drugs have changed, everything's changed, you know, nobody cares. If you don't have the stuff for addicts, they don't care at all who you used to be. Who you used to be makes no difference to an addict. You show up empty-handed on the street with nothing, their attention immediately is off you like you never existed. And they're making a beeline for who has the honey now. So I've experienced all of this. So I've experienced, you know, the worst of the world, how it actually works from one lifetime to the other, having hindsight, not just this life, but hindsight into another life, which was the key life to get the hindsight on. I've had many others, but right now they're not as important because this one really pointed out the full dynamic of what's going on here. So I thought, hey, maybe they showed up because they like me. Maybe they want to listen to my wisdom. Oh no, you don't have the stuff for them. They don't have any interest in you. You've got nothing for them. The addicts, if you don't have what the addicts want, you've got nothing for them. And I say, well, I got something better, you know, your own discipline and everyday practice. That's better because that'll free you from your addictions. So you won't feel so insecure. Oh, no, you don't have our drugs for us, you know, music drugs or whatever. You don't exist for us. You don't even exist. You got no purpose for us whatsoever, no meaning for us whatsoever. It's like, what? I thought you might want to, like, spend some time. No, wasting my time. I need my fix. This is it. Everybody's desperately scurrying for their fixes somehow, right? Scurrying for their fixes instead of actually spending the time practicing like this. Now, I have one ace up my sleeve in my life. Otherwise, I would have succumbed to suicide or something. It was so terrible. Nobody cared who I was. Nobody knew who I was. I had zero leverage over society and culture. Nothing. To go from Mr. Big Shot over everything to having zero influence, or this is, you know, from the penthouse to the outhouse, basically. Really, I was welcome in the finest, the most sumptuous palaces in Europe, run of everything, the very highest, best stuff, and then here I am sitting in a walnut orchard, you know, with nothing, and nobody cares. So the one ace that I had up my sleeve was what? Discipline in practicing. So I started out, I practiced, you know, I started trying music again. I said, well, how do I make a name of myself again? Wow. I thought it would carry over. It didn't. I just practiced 8-10 hours a day, sometimes more. until like my guitar, until my fingers were just like my hands, my fingers were just so trashed, you know, it was so painful I couldn't even do. But even then, I'd wait a little while and then do some more, and I'd wait a little while and do some more. So I was just super determined, just practice, 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 practice. Same thing, anything I did, like basketball, practice, 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 practice. I put a light outside, I'd be shooting till midnight. Be tired the next day at the high school, but you know what? I got to high school, we'd be playing, you know, teams, competition, and in physical education and whatever. You know, I just blow the doors off of everybody. But they didn't care, you know what I'm saying? Whatever. I was practicing till midnight every night, you know. You get good if you practice all the time. So I had that ability to just, you know, resolute determination, steady, resolute determination. If you're producing all these music drugs, you know, you got all these addicts after you, you know, you get up in the morning, you drink your coffee, and you're like composing all day long, you know, basically. Then you go out for dinner, next day, same thing, and you're tweaking everything. You're trying to produce this jewel for everybody. And you know, pressure, pressure, pressure. Got to live up to your name. So I had this ability then to just relentlessly work under pressure and every day. And so I used that to start on the spiritual path. I started studying spiritual truth and just every day I just absorb as much as I possibly could. And every day I started, I was about 10 years old, really working at it. So it's been 50 years. I said, maybe I better start paying. Maybe I can make a name for myself here somehow. I don't know. But I couldn't understand, what in the world are they talking about? I don't know. And is it, you know, just you keep working and working and working. And so practice, 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 practice. All I've done, work at it, work at it, work at it, work at it. Consider it, consider it, consider it. And then to hear that the Holy Spirit will deploy you in the right way to help out is wonderful. I'd like to know, you know, feel that, more of that, because then you feel at least somebody knows, something knows how to help us, everyone out, all right, to use your influence in the right way. Some there's some knowledge about that. So then if I can just follow along this advice and do that, then I will be helping everyone in the best way. So it's a very great relief to be aware of this. If you have a guru, it's a great relief, because the guru will tell you what to do, help you out with that. Ideally, we just do it intuitively, but it's certainly nice to also be working with a guru, yeah, I would say. So yeah, I've desperately been working to get a guru, because I want to use whatever influence I have in the right way. Knowing that if you don't do that, what's the use of it all, you know? And going through the despair that I went through with the collapse of Europe into war, and my influence didn't stop it, that I had to realize, you know what, even if you do something the right way, it doesn't necessarily stop wars and conflict in this world. I have to see that. So to know that you're actually doing the best you can do, then that stuff is not going to bother you so much. But if you're not sure, it's going to bother you a lot. Crisis is coming, you think, I should have done better. But if you know you're doing what the Holy Spirit told you to do, and you have to take a long-term picture, and you see that people here trying to believe in despair, the whole thing is based on despair. Once you see that, you realize, okay, that's what happens. They're purposely trying to generate enough despair to modify what they are, what they really are. So that's why they keep collapsing into these crises in the world. You get a picture of what's really going on, and then you're not so devastated by the things that happen, and you realize it's not all your fault. You don't take it to heart so much. You're like, oh, I should have done something better, or I could have avoided it. No. Unless you repent, you're going to chase after despair, period. So the whole focus has to be on successful repentance, which means successful practice, because you cannot hold your repentance. Repentance is a commitment to the path, commitment to right practice, is really repentance. You realize, I can't do it without that. I've got to do it. So then you need to carry through your repentance daily. This is what has to happen. So you need reminders of this, whether gurus or institutions or religion, whatever. You need that to remind people you've got to carry through daily on your repentance. You need to repent, which means daily practice. So this is what has to be emphasized. So this is how I want to use my influence, whatever it is. I don't have any influence, but if someday I ever should, to make sure that it's set on repentance now, and not on music, but on repentance. Otherwise, all the crises will just continue. This world's always been going through crises. And unless we repent, it will always continue on that way. It'll just continue on that way until we repent. There's no other answer for it at all. Because we are literally, intentionally pursuing ultimate despair, hoping this will change our spirit. Meaning we change an idea in the mind of God, we can change that idea. Meaning we're greater than God. We have a will stronger than God. Because it's God's will that no idea in God's mind can be changed. What we're trying to do is we're trying to change what we are, spirit, which is an idea in the mind of God. We're trying to change that. And if we can change it, that means we have a stronger will than God. So really, we're trying to be greater than God. This is true. This is what Jesus has told me. And this is what I have seen. I've corroborated this. This is true. We're trying to be greater than God. This is our central problem. The sin of spiritual arrogance. Trying to be greater than God. Now, God is not bothered by this. God knows we can't change what we are. But we're certainly miserable trying, because we're trying to change what we are through misery. Intentional misery. It's all this misery is intentional. Everything, the despair, the misery, everything we experience, the suffering, is absolutely 100% intentional on our part. And yet, try to take that away from people, they think you're trying to hurtle them into an abyss. Because they think without despair, they think this is their purpose. This is what they were created for, to change what they are. So if you say, well, you can't change what you are, they see that as an abyss of non-identity. The abyss of non-identity. So they're very much against taking this despair, you know, dropping this despair. No. We got to suffer. Don't tell me. And the last thing they want to hear is that this is all intentional. Because they think this is all just happening to them. We've set it up as if it's not intentional. We can't help it. If it was intentional, we could stop it. Right? So we have this world, we all believe that all this stuff that happens, it happens to us. There's nothing I could do about it, you know. All this misfortune's fate happens to me. You have to believe that in order to generate despair. If you realize that everything that you're experiencing is your own choice, then you have the power to change it, change what's happening. Decide, no, I don't want to experience this. I don't want to experience despair, so I'll avoid this. So if your goal is to modify what you are, try to be greater than God through despair, you are absolutely not going to listen to truth here. That you are completely in control of your own experiencing. No, I'm a victim, I'm a victim, I'm a victim. The victimization consciousness comes in. Say, no, I'm a victim. That's what you'll believe in. Victimization, you'll believe, the mentors you turn to will be victim addicts, those who promote the idea of victimization. Those will be the ones that you turn to, because they support your quest for despair, your quest to modify what you are. Those will be your companions. You know, you watch them on the TV, all this victimization, it's constant victimization, the victimization queen. Come on down, you've been victimized. I have too. I was so victimized so terribly. Come on down, tell us your victimization story. It's awful. They're so terrible what they did to you. I hope they rot in prison forever, you know. Oh, but you forgave them for what they did to you? Oh, you're so wonderful. You're so big. You're so much bigger than they are because they did this awful thing to you. But you forgave them? Oh, let everybody cheer you. What utter nonsense. There's nothing to forgive because nobody does anything to us. So they're despair addicts. And they're arrogance addicts. You know, they've not repented. This is modern culture, victim culture. It's really despair culture. And it's really arrogant culture. The notion that we can be greater than God is arrogance. It's a whim on our part that, hey, I wonder if we can be change what we are. If we did, we could be greater than God. Oh, let's try. But how do we do that? Yeah. Despair, utter despair, complete spiritual discouragement. I'll never get out of this hell. Oh, I'm so total despair. I'll never be free. I'll never be free. I've lost my freedom completely. And all I have is total mental chaos. Oh, such total despair. And then we're hoping, did that change what we were? Did that change it? No? Uh-oh. What do I do now? Right? Repent. Repent, repent, repent. So, nobody could force anybody to repent. So if someone doesn't want to repent, what could you do? You can't do anything. They'll still be chasing despair in their lives. And they may think you're lucky. Of course, they'll say you're lucky. If you're in bliss, well, it's luck. They have to believe in luck. If you're chasing despair, you have to believe in luck. So those who are enlightened, they'll just dismiss them. Well, it's an anomaly. Someone got lucky. It's just sometimes it happens in evolution that someone gets happy or something, whatever. They believe in evolution, they believe in all this, whatever, that, but it's not happening to me. It's not happening to me. No. Despair is going to happen to me. Yeah. And I'm going to be greater than God, but don't tell anyone. I don't want to know near that, but yeah, we're on the road to being greater than God, do they say? So they just believe you're lucky. They want to pay attention. They dismiss Jesus now, like, oh yeah, Jesus, well, he's whatever, He's not really helping me with my despair. If he could help me with my despair, that'd be another story. And they've kind of tried to get him to help. The church has sort of arranged it. So, yeah, well, Jesus will help with your despair. Yeah, don't worry. Oh, great. His mom will help you out too. Oh, great. Okay. We feel better now. Thank you. It's kind of getting worried there. So if you don't help him out with the despair, they have no use for you. They have no use for you at all. Jesus came, I said, I came to help the sinners, the poor in spirit, meaning those who have hit bottom with despair and realize it doesn't work. And they said, what do I do now? Despair doesn't modify what I am. Oh my gosh. And Jesus says, don't worry. You don't have to change what you are. God didn't create you to change what you were. God loves you just as you are. You don't have to try and change what you are. You're perfect. You're spirit. You're an idea in the mind of God. You can't change what you are. And so then those are the people who will listen to Jesus. Those who have repented, they realize, oh my gosh, I've got to really practice Jesus. I got to get free of this crazy idea I had. I got to get used to truth again. I forgot it. I got to get used to my true identity. I forgot it. And then Jesus says, I'm here for you. Don't worry. We'll get the right practices going for you, the right attitudes, the right disciplines. Be austere, simple, austere, kind. Love your enemies, don't get into arguments with anyone. Set the right tone, set the right pace, all of that for those who are willing to repent. For those who are not willing to repent, they just have tried to remake Jesus in their own image, to help them with despair. That's not really Jesus. Doing here, move it along, huh? Yeah. Well, whew, I have to settle down from all this. I got to do some driving, someone, and okay, wow. That's a good note to end on, isn't it? Powerful note to end on. Okay, so I don't know what's next, but I'll be ready for it. Right? So if you're watching these videos, very great. You're getting the flavor of it. You know, you're actually spending the time getting familiar. There's nothing that beats that, you know. That's the winner. The world, those chasing after despair, they're not going to help you. They won't help you with this. This is my experience. They won't help you with this. If you don't have the drugs that help them keep them chasing despair, they don't have it. They won't give you the time of day. Okay? So give yourself the time of day. Give yourself the time of day to practice. Repentance is something you practice every day. Repentance is that which you practice every day, full stop on the wow, which enables you to get back in the flow of just every day, you know, the despair of this world, just a function. That's fine. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. That's it.